It's the end of the week, and so it's time to take out the trash. Okay, it's been a trashy old week. So, Brett, who's your garbage person of the week?
My garbage person of the week is someone, I'm not sure if they've been a garbage person yet, but it's Tucker Carlson. Tucker Carlson.
Wait, who is this?
Tucker. I'm using a T, but the name actually starts with F on his birth certificate, and I'm gonna need to see the long form birth certificate. Tucker Carlson is, and I might have said that wrong, but then again, so did Jan Bongino. Tucker Carlson is going after Adam Kinzinger in this very petulant ongoing feud where one time, so Adam Kinzinger does not like Tucker Carlson. And so Tucker Carlson is finding ways to pee on Adam Kinzinger, and he's seizing upon this crying thing, which I'll explain in a second, but it is an ongoing issue. Here is a clip from Tucker Carlson's show where he talks about Adam Kinzinger crying. Take a look.
We brought you reports last night that Congressman Adam Kinzinger of Illinois had been seen crying again. We promised to get to the bottom of that story. Members of Congress are, technically speaking, sent to Washington to vote and not to weep. And so we thought it was worth following up. Tonight we have an update on that.
So he has an update. So this is not the first time he's talked about Adam Kinzinger crying. You might ask, what was the deal? The reason that Adam Kinzinger cried in the first place, I'm going to save for the end of this, just to reveal how horrible Tucker Carlson is. But here is the update that Tucker Carlson has on his show.
Congressman Kinzinger has been spotted crying again, according to our sources, in a place where you rarely see tears, in Waffle House. You're seeing the Waffle House location on your screen. If you look closer, you will see Adam Kinzinger clearly distraught, crying inside a restaurant that serves waffles. According to our sources, it's unclear exactly why he was crying. A shortage of boysenberry syrup, said one. Links, patties were not available, said another. We can't tell you more.
You can't tell us more because you made it up, you photoshopped it. This is a bit that he has.
Yeah.
He was not crying in a Waffle House. People cry in Waffle House all the time because it's where you eat when you're drunk. And third, all that stuff that Tucker is listing to try to convince you that he has ever in his life been to a Waffle House is all totally made up. He asks an intern, what is a waffle? Is it just waffles? What do they have? Well, give me a word like patties. Oh, that's a patties.
He's describing
what they call the
IHOP.
I don't know. I've never been to a Waffle House, but I'm not from that area. But I've been to IHOP.
Okay.
The reason, here's the reason. And then we'll show you the next story that he did after this to show you how ridiculous Tucker Carlson is. The reason that Adam Kinzinger was crying in the first place was because he was listening to the account of a police officer who was beaten on January 6th.
This is that PR we were talking about.
During the hearing on January 6th, Adam Kinzinger was overcome with a little bit of emotion and didn't cry. He may have teared up, but Adam Kinzinger, who's no friend of mine, got emotional because America was under attack. And so Tucker is doing everything he can to belittle other people, including masquerading as a man of the people who knows jack squat about Waffle House. Up yours, Tucker Carlson. But listen, Tucker only spent a very brief time on that bit of news before moving on to the next story, which was wildly important. Here's his transition.
But if we see Adam Kinzinger crying again, you will see it here first. So for many years, UFOs were the province of wacko.
It's the biggest news show in the country.
There you go.
So yeah, I love that you pointed out what it was that started this. Again, it's PR for domestic terrorists. If you criticize domestic terrorists, you're the bad guy, not the domestic terrorists. Anyway, my biggest issue with it is I didn't think he was actually at a Waffle House crying. I get that he was doing a bit. It has been sucked dry of anything even accidentally funny. There's no humor to it, no levity. He's not enjoying it. The person who wrote it didn't enjoy it. The person who photoshopped it didn't enjoy it. Were people at home laughing?
Yes.
I can't imagine that they were.
Yeah, they were though. They were
It's not funny. There's no joke. I don't understand what the problem that the right has with humor. Don't they have comedians they like?
I'll tell you exactly what it is. They do the laugh that's not based on them actually finding it funny. It's their desperate need to avoid personal responsibility. Even though the personal responsibility of critical race theory, which they keep going to, is not, there is no, I don't voice personal responsibility on you for all the legacy of racism in America. But the perception that maybe, because they know that's guilt that they have, the perception that they might need to pay attention to the guilt, their desperation to avoid that, any responsibility, is what drives it. And that's why they're like,
ugh. It's an unwatchable show. Anyway, for my garbage person of the week, I've got a classic for you, and it is going to be Elon Musk, because of his most recent announcement that his company is working on a humanoid robot and that will build a prototype sometime next year. You can see a photo of it. We'll go to the photo, looks perfectly fine. My issue is that Elon Musk and Tesla, who have gobbled up every engineer in the country that has ungodly amounts of money, some of it given by the government, continues to do this stupid BS. And I know what you're probably thinking. Oh wait, John, you're acting as if this is serious. I think it's just a joke or whatever. Sure, I'm sure there's a good chance it's just a joke. And that's kind of part of the problem. That, like, I don't know, the company that has the most potential to do significant things just constantly jokes around, or maybe not. The flamethrower was supposed to be a joke and then he made it. Most of these things are just jokes until he puts tons of time and resources and thought and engineers into it. I tweeted about this. I have a simple request. It's a complex idea. Maybe he could put his best engineers on it. And it is, could your car company make a car people can afford? That would be a great problem to crack. It's not a walking robot, but it could actually help some people. It might improve the country, but no, that's not as fun as coming up with jokes or stealing memes or, you know, talking about your boring company that after years made a tunnel that one car could go through or whatever. He's the genius, I know. And more importantly, he's surrounded himself with actual geniuses, but this is a stupid BS that he does. And it annoys me in multiple ways. One, that there are actual problems that his group has the talent to solve. And two, that in making a mockery of all this, he makes me not excited for humanoid robots or space travel or flamethrowers or whatever. I want to be able to enjoy those things, but he's ruined it because of all the wasted potential. I'm not even going into the details about it, about the stupid robot, because he's not going to make it. They still don't have self-driving cars that actually work. He's going to make a robot that walks around. It's a slightly different thing, but he acts as if everything is a joke. And it's just, there are actual crises. We need our best minds on them. Brett, tell me how I'm the bad guy. John, sure I'm the bad guy.
Well, you've seen Ex Machina so many times that I just can't believe you on this. I've seen
it like three times.
All right, I've seen it like five times.
It's a very good movie.
Such a good movie. If the robot wasn't so hot, I'd be on your side. But there's something about that sleek.
What?
Just that sleek bod. It's eye catching.
Strapless tunic. You are now my garbage.
It dresses like Marjorie Tyrell.
It does dress like Marjorie Tyrell. It's the Taquito 2000 that we've got there. Anyway, yeah, he's not gonna make it. I hate him. I just hate him. I hate everything about him. Anyway,
and his promotion was like, it's a robot that won't fight back, and just like flailing to be like, fight back like what? A wife, a slave, a worker, a what? What is the won't fight back? Benefit of the doubt. You're saying like, this is not an android that will cause the end of the world.
That's good branding. Anyway, that's my garbage person. But more importantly, what did you all think? So 26,000 of you voted in our poll this week. And here are your top five. Coming in at number five with 4% of the vote is Charlie Kirk for his comments about Ilhan Omar. He only got 4% because he's the worst and nobody likes him. Even the people who hate these people don't really care that much about him. That is Charlie Kirk. Coming in at number four with 10% of the vote is Sean Hannity for using the crisis in Afghanistan to sell products. Thankfully, it looks like that has ended for now. Number three with 17% of the vote, Representative Boebert for praising the Taliban for building back better. Ugh. Number two with 21% of the vote, Tucker Carlson for immediately vilifying Afghan refugees. That seems like a big, I never can guess who's gonna win. I thought that would have won. But your garbage person of the week, chosen by the community with 47% of the vote, is the GOP for scrubbing the Trump-Taliban deal from their website. So and look, good. Substantively, trying to bamboozle people into not understanding how broad the blame for the situation there is worthy of it. So thank you to all of you who voted.
Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.